Morning, Trainiacs. We're back from Puerto Rico. And it is like Winnipeg's version of Puerto Rico nice out there.
Minus two.
So now that I'm back, starting to analyze all of the efforts that I did, seeing how good or bad the swim, bike, run was. And the run is the biggest thing that I've got a question about. I think it's also the biggest place that people struggle with. It's where I struggle. And it's where I think there is the biggest potential for improvement. So, I think I've got some interesting ways to kind of normalize that race against a bunch of other races and see if it was actually an underperformance or actually a really good performance. All right, so coming into Half Ironman Puerto Rico, I had wanted to put out a better run performance than I'd done in anything of 2018. I had PB run performances in Half Ironman Coeur d'Alene and Half Ironman Worlds, but I thought that I could take those like 134, 135 half marathon kind of performances in those races, and I would have hopefully improved that by doing more quality, longer runs, getting me down to somewhere around 132 race kind of fitness. What do? A 141. So like a lot of people, when that happens, my initial reaction is to say like, oh, well, I really screwed up the run, but it's not as simple as that. So when this happens and you need to look back on a performance, specifically with your running, there are three factors that I would look at. Number one being pacing, number two being placing, number three being performance. And I'm going to show you how I'm looking at my performance in Half Ironman Puerto Rico and potentially how you can look at other race performances that you've done. Okay, so I was targeting about a 430, 425 per kilometer kind of pace, but that is in ideal scenarios. That's in about 70 degree weather, that's on a flat course. And I know that's not actually going to be the case. So what we can do when we see that my pace is actually 453, resulting in a 141 half, we start looking at factors that might end up adjusting that pace and saying, all right, well, that was our target pace, but did we put out that kind of target effort? And just based on the course and the conditions, it was off. And one of the first things that we can look at is here, runworks.com, and I'm going to give you a bunch of links and tools, and I'll link them all in the description below. But runworks.com has a nice calculator where you can put in a target pace or a recent race, and let's say I go with that 132 that I was going to try, and we can calculate equivalent finish times at other temperatures for this race, saying 70 was my ideal temperature, and then we calculate, we hit go, and we see at other temperatures what it would have been. So we are close to about 90, so that means that even if I did have that 132 performance, I still would have been more like a 135.09. So right there, I'm instantly 3 minutes, 9 seconds slower. What about the elevation? Because Puerto Rico had a huge amount of elevation. Well, this I don't find is really great for those calculators. So for that, what we can look to is sort of what is common practice out there. And on Runners Connect, I'll link to this, but what it says is work by Jack Daniels of Daniels Running Formula fame claims that every percent gradient incline going uphill will slow you down by about 12 to 15 seconds per mile. And every percent gradient decline will aid you by 8 seconds per mile. So even on a looped course, the more hills there are, the slower you're going to go because the inclines hurt you more than the declines help you. So what we can then do is go to my training peaks and look at, say, Coeur d'Alene, which was the closest that I've got to that 132 performance. And we can take the difference between that, where the elevation gain and loss was 100 meters gained, 100 meters lost, Compare that to Puerto Rico, which was 620 meters of gain and 591 meters lost. And we can take that, go to inchcalculator.com. This is a grade calculator that you show how much the rise was, how much incline there was, and how long it was. And it gives you a percentage grade. So yada, 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 calculate all that. And I'll pull these notes in that I've got here. Now the course in Puerto Rico, after all those calculations, has a 2.46% incline, resulting in 6 minutes, 33 seconds slower than Coeur d'Alene. It does, however, have a 2.33% average decline, resulting in a 6 minute and 4 second faster performance than Coeur d'Alene, resulting in a net change of 29 seconds slower. Combine that with the roughly 3 minutes and 9 seconds from the heat, we're looking at, even if I wanted to do that same 132 performance, I would have been more like, on a good day, if I had nailed it, still close to 136. Doesn't quite get me to the 141. So then let's start looking at the next P, placing. Instantly, everyone's going to start looking at where their place was overall and in the age group, but that's not very accurate. It depends on who shows up. It depends on how many people are in your age group. One tool that I like to use is obstried.com, the Obsessed Triathlete. And this is my buddy Christoph, who is also a Tower 26 athlete. He's actually the guy that created the Tower 26 website with head coach Jerry. And he creates a measurement called DPI, which is the Division Performance Index. And it gives you a measurement relative to how you did in the field. So I look at my place in Puerto Rico and I was 54th fastest overall run split. But what does that mean? How do we put that into context? Well, on OBS Try, you can type in your name and it'll give you a bit of an indication of how you did overall in the race. And as you can see, based off of this, this was the best performance that I'd done. The DPI, the higher the number is, the better you are overall. So this was theoretically my best performance, but let's look at just the run performance. So my DPI for Half Ironman Puerto Rico on the run was a 92.7. Compare that to Worlds, that was an 89.8. So this was, even though it was a slower time, it was theoretically a better run. Compare it to Coeur d'Alene, which was a very good run, that was a 93.4. So I was slightly lower, even though the time was 7 minutes slower. So that tells you a little bit of like how you performed, and you can also take that and instead of placing yourself in the field, what you can do is place yourself relative to the fastest athlete, because the faster you go in a race, the more predictable your time is. The narrower the band gets between a good performance and a bad performance. So at the tippy top, the pinnacle of race times, you're gonna see times that tend to be fairly reliable. So what you can do is take your time and figure out the percentage difference from the fastest time. I did that manually myself, and the delta, that's the difference between my time and the fastest time in Puerto Rico, was 19.7% difference. Compare that to Coeur d'Alene, which was a really good race, like I say, which that was a 17.7% difference. So I did not do nearly as well, but the difference between my time and the fastest time in Worlds was a 30% difference. In my opinion, that just goes to show that the faster you get, like in Worlds, everyone is very fast. The faster you get, the faster your run has to get. But if you're like me looking at this right now, you're like, all right, Taryn, we don't know what this means. That's where the third P comes in. Performance. How did you actually perform? And for that, what I like to look at is just literally the run itself. So right here we have Half Ironman Coeur d'Alene, and what I see is a fairly level heart rate, climbing slightly towards the end, but it's around 170 beats a minute, just a little bit higher than that. Meanwhile, the pace did drop off towards the end of the race, and that's kind of what I remember it feeling like. However, the heart rate for Puerto Rico was a little bit lower. It was in the 160s, mid 160s. What I like seeing though is that it didn't drop off. So that means I didn't blow myself up, push my heart rate too high, and end up causing it to collapse. You see that the pace is all over the map, and that's just a result of the hills. But in general, it probably does trend down a little bit. So I want to then see, was there a point that I fell apart? And I can use the stride running power meter for that, the foot pod that I reviewed. Here, we've got the foot pod data from Half Ironman Worlds. I like this second to last column, and it's leg spring stiffness. It's how quick are you able to get off the ground? A really good sign of how your form is. And it was in around 11. And then towards about mile 7, 8, I started breaking down 10.4, 10.6. So I did have a breakdown. Let's go and look at the run from Puerto Rico. I go out in 10.2, I got a 10.3, a 10.1, a 10, so dipping a little bit, and then a 10.1, a 10.2, and a 10.2, and a 10.1. So I didn't break down, and that's how it felt. It just felt slow right from the start. Take a look at this though. Related to that, see how in Half Ironman Worlds, I had some 11s, I had some 10.9s, and then it dipped down to a 10.1. This basically started at a 10.2, and stayed at a 10.2, 10.1. Relate that to the heart rate data between Coeur d'Alene, where I was able to get my heart rate around 170, whereas I wasn't able to get my heart rate up to 170 at all on Puerto Rico. What we're seeing is right from the start, my performance numbers were lower. Next question is, did I push too hard on the bike then because I got off the bike and started going slower right from the go? That's the last thing we're going to look at. We've got two really comparable bike splits because I basically targeted the same power in Puerto Rico as I did in Half Ironman Worlds. Half Ironman Worlds, I had a normalized power of 231. Get this? Normalized power of 231 in Puerto Rico. Little bit of difference here that my average heart rate in Puerto Rico is 162. Where my average heart rate in Port Elizabeth Worlds was 159. Very, very comparable. And I would say, if anything, my biking fitness was a fair bit better this year. And in Half Ironman World Championships, where I went slower, I actually felt a fair bit of fade towards the end of the bike. So I would say that I executed a much better bike, a much faster bike, obviously, and I was probably fresher coming off the bike. So that all then gets back to the original question. Did I overperform, underperform, or perform well? Based off of this, I would say that there's signs that I performed well, but also signs that I underperformed a little bit. Why is that? Well, we basically just know that I got off the bike and right from the start, I had a harder time pushing faster, which makes sense. It was hillier, so I couldn't get into a groove. It was hotter, so I had to keep my heart rate low to make sure that I didn't blow up. Now, the final answer is, I don't really know what all of this data says conclusively. What I do say that is a little bit more reliable is, how did you feel? And I felt like I just wasn't able to perform as well as I thought I could have. As soon as I got onto the run, I felt stiffer. I felt like I couldn't open up my stride. I felt like my heart rate was just kind of limiting me and I had to stay a fair bit slower and that I couldn't get into a groove with the hills. And if that's the case and the feeling is like I probably could have performed better, I think that's probably a better indication of what the potential is. Stride, training peaks, all of these calculations that we do, they're a helpful tool, but really the most important thing in the end is how did you perform and how did you feel? Because that's all we got. Like, we know the truth, whereas that can kind of just give us helpful indications. So I work on running a little bit more. A lot of us need to work on running a little bit more. I got some ideas about how to run a little bit better. One of which being working with Dan Plouze so that my fuel stores by going with a low carb, high fat approach last a fair bit longer in a race. And if you want the free resources that Dan actually put together as he starts consulting me in this, you can go to triathlonterran.com/theplouze. Really nice little package of like how to get started with low carb, high fat training, and it's going to be super interesting. So check that out and make sure you're subscribed because we're starting the project with Dan Plouze to build into Challenge Roth right now. Later, Trainiacs, I'm back.